to Sister Circle Live. Our next guest is just too talented. He has recorded with all of the greats and then some, from Whitney Houston to Luther Vandross.
Oh, yes, and he's literally been all over the globe recording his latest album, Humanité. Please welcome Grammy Award-winning saxophonist and recording artist, Kirk Whalum.
Yay! Hello, hello, good morning, bonjour.
You
shined
down to the circle today.
Oh, man, I gotta be kind of soft because y'all.
Have a seat here on the purple pillow. Yeah. And I love that color combination.
Well,
my God, it's very nice.
You know, the African thing, you know, African men. When I lived in Paris, I noticed every time I saw an African man, he was sharp.
He was sharp.
Always.
Mm-hmm. So speaking of sharp, your career has been sharp. When I tell you, you have over 25 solo recordings, take us back to the very beginning.
Sure.
And how you kind of started in this business and how your direction has kind of evolved.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So the thing, I call it the sandwiches, right? This is my sandwich scenario. I was in South Africa with Whitney Houston in 1994 for the One South Africa tour. She's singing Amazing Grace, and we're used to, you know, her blowing us away. But in this moment, she looked back and she said, "Bishop, you play." So Bishop was my nickname because I used to always do the Bible study. Uh-huh. So now she looks at me like, "You play," and in the second, with 75,000 people, a mixed race audience for the first time legally, right? Because apartheid ended in 1994.
Wow.
And then live on HBO, I don't know, 7 million people watching live. Mm-hmm. "You play," all of a sudden, I'm playing the song, the very first song I learned. Okay, when I was 12,
wow.
I played that song at my dad's church. My dad pastored a church in Memphis, Tennessee, where I now live again. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so in this moment, I'm playing Amazing Grace for a whole bunch of people.
Right, yes, look at that.
So that's really where it all started. It started with me playing in church, and them sisters, "Oh, honey, you can really play. You can play, you're the best. You can play that thing."
Yeah.
I didn't realize I probably sounded terrible. Like, I'm like, honk, honk, you know. But they, you know, it was that affirmation of being in that black church and the people loved you and they gave you a little bit more credit than you deserve.
Right.
Then later on you find out, I actually have to practice and go get, you know, go to college and stuff. So, but you know, put those together.
Yeah. Well, you talked about being from Memphis. I am too. I am as well.
I know. You think
but,
I don't?
But at 9 years old, Martin Luther King was assassinated. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated literally blocks away from the home you grew up in. How did that shape your worldview and your artistry?
Well, first of all, it wrecked me because as a 9-year-old, you can't process something that big. Mm-hmm. And, you know, somebody important getting killed is one thing, but this was different. This was a spiritual catastrophe. Yeah. This is something that happened that had global and historic and spiritual connotation, right? Mm-hmm. So in other words, the forces of good and evil, you know, because as you know, he didn't just happen to get shot, and James Earl Ray so did not kill him. So there was some forces at work. You know, there's a book called An Act of State that everybody should read. But anyway, yeah, so as a 9-year-old, I couldn't process it. So emotionally, I went through years and years and years of trying to deal with it, but not even knowing, you know, what is that I'm dealing with, right? So yes, absolutely, it impacted me emotionally and spiritually, but man, as an artist, I keep reflecting back on it. What is it that he was saying? Why did he get killed? Well, it was because of the beloved community.
Yeah.
It was the beloved community. It was about people who were poor and marginalized and otherized and, you know, xenophobia and racism, and all that stuff was mixed into his message. And that had implications because guess what? The Vietnam War was happening. They were like, "We don't really want you saying that."
Wow.
And so he got killed.
Well, let's transition to something that was colossal for you and for all of us as music lovers and, you know, people who create music.
Yeah.
Just the same. The infamous solo on the record, "I Will Always Love You."
Yeah.
Yes. My God.
Right. Yeah.
Did you know that it was going to be that big when you were a part of it, when it was being created?
No, not at all.
It was a remake.
I would have practiced a whole lot more if I had known, you know, like I would have really been, I'd have had the solo all mapped out. And, you know, it probably wouldn't have been as good. But here's the story. Whitney insisted on doing the song live for the film, which was not a good idea as far as the directors were concerned. They're like, no, you know. They're like, oh, yeah, that's a great idea, Whitney. but they really did not want to do
it. Right.
So then she says, you know what? I have to. I can't explain it to you, but I need to do this live. And I need my band playing live as I sing live to the film. Like, this is not going to happen. They know it's not going to happen. But eventually she said, well, okay, so if that's the way you got to do it, then bad news, you got a problem. You're going to have to find a singer. Because if I do it, I'm going to do it live to the film, and my band's going to play.
Wow. We have to take a break, but when we get back, we will talk more with Kirk about his new music and the documentary, so stick around.
Well, we are back with Grammy Award-winning saxophonist Kurt Whalum, and that is music that I was jamming to his new album, Humanity.
Now, Kurt, let's get on down into your music.
Yes.
Okay, you have not released an album in 4 years. You have one coming out in October, October 11th to be exact. What is it what is different about this album than all of the other albums? Because you have recorded all over this world, literally.
Right. So first of all, the four-year hiatus. Now I turned 60, so that was.
Come on, 60. You look good.
This is all about my birthday present to myself.
Okay.
So I went all over the world. I did collaborations with 14 artists in 8 countries. Mm. Documented the whole thing. You see some of the artists in the cover there. And it was about emerging artists, some established artists. The number one artist in South Africa, Zahara. Number one artist in Indonesia, Afghan, Muslim brother, Bad Cat. Man, I had such a good time. So basically, I am now officially UNKIRK. I'm Unc Kirk, okay? I'm Uncle Kirk to all these young artists, beautiful young artists. And that's what it was about. It was about me doing collaborations with young artists who are gonna make their impact on the global stage as opposed to, okay, this is what's going on in the States.
Let's talk a little bit about your documentary, and you noted it just a moment ago, but how did conducting the documentary impact you? What did you learn about yourself?
Oh God, I learned so much. First of all, the fact that the title, Humanité, is about humanity. It's about, this is what we all share the same blood. Mm-hmm. We're one, right? Mm-hmm. But we have so many various and diverse and beautiful colors and styles, and you know, because you're from Japan and I'm from the States, we're made out of the same thing.
Right,
you
right. Know? Yeah. Well, I'm excited about your project and your journey and how talented and amazing you are. We're so thankful that you came down to the circle.
You.
Thank you for joining us today. Be on the lookout for his new album, Humanité, dropping on October 11th on all digital music platforms.
And the conversations continue on all social media platforms. You know, you got it at SisterCircleTV.com.